Okay, so when we are talking about investment, we talk about two instruments of investment. First, debt instrument and equity instrument. A company can buy debt or shares from the market as investment. Okay, so if the company has idle cash and then they want to make money from that idle cash, they can purchase investment by purchasing the debt securities or equity securities, which is share, common share from capital market. So why a company invests? They, of course, they want to earn high return. They want to secure some of the operation or financing arrangement. For example, in the financial industries like bank, they have short-term, mostly they have short-term liabilities. Because in bank, they have saving account here, saving account, or they have deposit account, right? And all the accounts as the liability, this is the liability, right? It is short term. So for example, your account, your saving account in bank, you need to withdraw your money anytime, right? So it is short term liabilities. However, when the bank use this money mostly for credit or for loan, and the loan and the credit is long term. Mostly the loan or the credit are long term. It can be commercial credit for the company. It can be consumer credit. It can be housing. Or housing credit or housing loan, and so on. And mostly these are long-term. So the operation of bank need to be secure because they have short-term liabilities in one side and long-term asset in another side. So how to save, how to protect the short-term liabilities in order to give you facilities that you can withdraw your money anytime. So one way to manage this mismatch by purchasing short-term investment as their asset. Yeah, si banknya punya liability short term seperti tabungan Anda yang harus bisa diambil sewaktu-waktu. Di sisi lain, aset bank adalah long term dalam bentuk commercial credit, housing, and so on. Jadi untuk menutup mismatch ini, bank bisa investasi pada sekuritas jangka pendek seperti obligasi maupun saham misalnya. Okay. Or to for the strategic purpose. For example, the famous F&B company in France, which is Danone. Danone know that in Indonesia we have very well known mineral water product, which is Aqua, and then Danone invest in the Aqua common share, and now Danone become the parent company, become the investor of Aqua, and they issue or they make a product called Danone Aqua, as we know in the market. Now they use this product. So it's also it also has strategic purpose behind the investment. Okay, so now we are going to talk about the accounting. To do the accounting or to manage this investment, we have to consider these two questions. First, what is the business model in having that investment? In other words, why the firm, why the company purchased that investment? For what? And then the second question, what are the contractual cash flow characteristics of the financial investment? The answer of these two questions will determine how the company treat, how the company do accounting for the investment. And for your information, this topic is quite complicated in our accounting standard. So although this lecture tried to simplify all the assumption, all the description of the accounting standard, I cannot avoid to introduce some complexity related to the accounting. So we have two instruments. Previously, I already explained that we have two instruments available for investment, which is debt, which are debt and equity or share. To answer the first question, if you have debt instrument or equity instrument, the first question, what is the business model, the best business model in managing this investment? For investment in debt, there are two business models. First, you held this investment for collection. You hold this investment until its maturity. Okay. Business model pertama untuk instrumen utang, perusahaan pegang sampai maturitinya. Perusahaan pegang sampai pelunasannya, held for collection. Okay. So if the company hold this investment, this debt investment for collection, then the most important return for the company is the contractual cash flow, which is the interest and the principal. Kalau investasinya dipegang sampai jatuh tempo, artinya fitur utama dari investasi ini adalah return periodiknya, yaitu bunga, dan cash flow untuk pembayaran pokoknya di in the end of the maturity. Okay. So if it is the case, then the method is called amortized cost. However, if the company hold this investment for trading purpose, okay, for trading purpose, or it is held for collection, but there will be a possibility to sell this investment, then the method will be fair value. In other words, actually, there are three class of investment. First, HTM, held to maturity, or held for collection, it's the same. Mostly for debt. So for debt, we have this investment until its maturity. We held this bond until the collection. And the main feature, the main the main return is from the interest. Okay. Second, I buy this debt investment because I'm a trader. So I will sell the investment anytime I can get high return by selling this investment. For example, I purchase a bond for 100,000, then I can sell it for 120,000, so I got a 20,000 gain. That is for trading. If the investment purpose is for trading, then we have to use fair value method. Okay. Or the other option is I have this investment for held to maturity. I mean, I will have this investment until its maturity, but there is a possibility to sell it before the maturity. Or it mix between that two, the previous two. So saya pegang ini sampai jatuh tempo, tapi it is possible to sell it anytime if I need cash. Although the initial purpose is to have this investment until its maturity. So if it is mixed purpose, then the fair value method should be used. So three class of financial asset depend on the initial purpose of investment and also the business model of managing this investment. How the company manage the investment will determine what is the appropriate model or what is the appropriate method to use. Jadi ada tiga kelas, ada tiga kelompok investasi aset keuangan. Yang tiga kelas ini bergantung pada tujuan investasi dan model pengelolaan atau model bisnis investasi. If the investment is held for maturity, then you have to use amortized cost. If the investment is held for trading, then you have to use fair value method. If it is mixed, then it is a fair value method. Okay, so we're gonna start from the first method, which is amortized cost. Okay. Debt investment are characterized by contractual payments on specified dates of the interest and the principal. Okay. So the principal will be received in the end of the maturity date, and the interest will be received any interest payment date, right? Can be once per year or semi-annual. It depends on the contract of the debt. And companies group debt investment into three categories: held for collection, if the company want to have this investment until its maturity, and the company wants to enjoy the interest and also the principal payment in the end of the maturity, or it can be for trading or mix. For the first and the last class, I think it's quite straightforward because the purpose is significantly different. In the last purpose, the company want to just want to have this investment as a as an inventory. So they treat this investment as their inventory. They buy and then they sell it. Mereka beli lalu jual lagi. They want to enjoy the capital gain or the gain from the selling of the instrument. But in the first purpose, what they want or what the company want is the interest payment. But the second is actually the mix between the first and the third. Dalam kasus apa yang kedua ini muncul? Dalam kasus misalkan kembali ke contoh bank tadi, bank is not a trader. Bank mostly they don't do trading, but they cannot avoid to sell the instrument anytime they need cash. Jadi mereka beli investment, mereka bukan trader, so it's not their inventory. The investment is not their inventory, but it's not possible. I mean, it is possible for them to sell the instrument anytime they need cash. So selling the investment is an incidental event. Jadi penjualannya itu incidental. Incidental. It's not their main operation to sell the investment. But in the last purpose, selling the instrument is their main purpose of investment. Okay, so please remember different purpose, different business model will determine different method. Okay, closer look at the debt investment. So because we have three class or three group, then we have three method. Okay, for the first method we call amortized cost, and the amortized cost is actually the same as you already learned in chapter 14. When you do the debt in debt or bonds payable, so it's actually the other side of chapter 14 is amortized cost. So in chapter 14 you do accounting from the debtor side. Okay. Di chapter 14 Anda melakukan akuntansi untuk bonds payable dari sisi debitur, but in this case or in this chapter you do accounting from the opposite side, which is from the investor side. But the method is the same. I mean, the calculation, the computation is exactly the same as you did in chapter 14, but you take different angle or different position. It is amortized cost. So if you have any, if the bonds have any premium or discount, you have to amortize the premium, the discount using effective interest method. You have to build the bonds premium and discount amortization table and so on. So it's exactly the same way, but different perspective or different position. This is amortized cost. I have. I really hope you still remember what you did in chapter 14. And for the last purpose is for trading. The company should use fair value method. In fair value method, any changes of the market price of the investment will affect the investment presented on the balance sheet. So in any balance sheet date, the company should adjust the value of the investment to the market price. Okay. And the difference between the previous carrying amount and the current market value, the difference will be recognized in the net income, which is a profit or loss statement. Okay. So the revenue is from the interest and also from the changing of from the changes of the value, the market value, and also from gain or loss from the sale. Jadi untuk tujuan yang ketiga adalah tujuan trading. Modelnya atau metode akuntansinya adalah fair value. Setiap ada perubahan selisih nilai antara nilai tercatat dengan harga pasar, maka nilai tercatatnya harus menyesuaikan, baik itu naik ataupun turun. Okay. So this adjustment will be recognized as part of the net income. Diakui sebagai bagian dari net income di profit loss statement. Okay. And what about the second purpose, which is mix? So it is help for collection and also selling. If it is the case, the method called for fair value as well. However, so because this is fair value method, at any balance sheet date, the company should adjust the investment value to the market value, and any differences, which is gain or loss, will be recognized as other comprehensive income, and this other comprehensive income is part of the equity. So it's different. Account from the trading, from the trading method. Jadi kalau di tujuan trading, selisih perubahan nilai menjadi bagian dari net income. Kalau tujuannya bukan trading, tapi tujuan held for collection and selling, selisih perubahan nilai investasi dicatat sebagai bagian dari equitas. Okay. So we're going to take a look one by one. So the first one is amortized cost. As I told you, the amortized cost will be the same as you learn in chapter 14, but in this chapter you're gonna take a different position from the creditor position. So for instance, the company Robinson purchased 100,000 bonds with 8% coupon of Evermaster AG on January 1st, 2019 at a discount, paying 92,278 euro. The bonds mature January 1st, 2024 and yield 10%. 10% is the market rate of the bonds. Interest payable semi-annually. So at the purchase or at the purchase date, Robinson, which is the creditor, will record debit bond investment or debt investment and credit cash for 92,000 euro as the sales price or the market price of the bonds. Jadi dicatat sebesar fair value atau harga pasar dari bondsnya. So at this point, I think it's no problem at all. And then we, because the bond has discount, then we have to build, we have to develop this discount amortization schedule. Okay, as you did in chapter 14. So I will not explain this table anymore. The first column is the date, is the interest payment date. Interest payment date. And then the second column is the coupon, right? The coupon, the nominal interest. And then the interest revenue is from the market rate, which is 10%. And then the next is bond amortization, bond discount amortization. And then the last is carrying amount of bonds. So I think you still remember how to make this table. So in 1st July, a creditor, which is Robinson, will receive 4,000 euro cash from the interest or from the coupon. And then Robinson should also amortize the discount, which is 614, by making this entry. It debits the cash, and then debiting the debt investment and interest revenue. So why does Robinson, the creditor, debit debt investment in order to amortize the discount? Because in the first January 2019, the bonds is 92,000. However, in the end of the maturity, the bond should be exactly 100,000 euro, right? As you can see in the previous table, in this table. So in the end of the maturity, the bond should be 100,000. So to amortize discount of bond investment means you increase the carrying amount of bonds little by little until the bonds become its carrying value, the carrying value of bonds become the same as the nominal value of bonds. The amortisasi discount obligasi akan menambah investasi obligasi sedikit demi sedikit sehingga nilai tercatatnya akan sama dengan nominal value-nya. And the nominal value of this bond is actually 100,000. Okay. So in the 1st January, the company or Robinson will receive 400,000 as the interest payment. However, in the end of December 2019, this 4,000 will be recorded as interest receivable. And the amortization as well should be recorded in 2019, December 31st. So this journal will be repeated every year until the end of the maturity of the bonds. Okay. So in the end of 2019, the financial statement will show debt investment carrying amount, which is 93,537. It is from the table here. This balance will be shown as carrying amount of bond investment in the end of December 2019. And interest receivable also will appear in statement of financial position. And on the income statement, there will be interest revenue recorded for 9,259. Again, it's actually from the interest revenue recorded on the table. Okay, so the accounting will be the same across years during the maturity until the maturity of the bonds. However, now assume that Robinson sells its investment on November 1st, 2021 at 99.75 plus accrued interest. Okay, what does it mean? Anyone can explain what does 99.75? Anyone?
Oh, is it the price?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
How, So how to compute?
So is it 99.75 times? So because it is discount, so the price. This the price has a what is the price?
I don't know. It's 99.75% times.
Yeah, I think so.
Times what?
Times the price.
No. Times the not the price, it's the nominal value. What is the nominal value?
The
in this case, what is the main what is the nominal value?
Was it the original price that over?
No, no. Berapa nilai nominalnya di kasus ini? Is it 100,000? My God. See, kayaknya Anda nggak terlalu paham deh dengan chapter 14. Nanti ini akan bermasalah di chapter 16. Atau chapter 16, chapter 17. So please go back to the chapter 14 to make it more clear for you. So the cash, before selling the bonds, the company should amortize the discount from July 21 to November 2021. Okay, diamortisasi dari Juli ke November. Berarti 4 bulan dari total 6 bulan ya. Kan amortisasinya per 6 bulan. Mengikuti jumlah pembayaran tunainya. Ini saya yakin dia bingung nih secara matematik, tapi saya nggak mau tahu ya. I don't want to know. It is your duty to understand, to learn. If you have question, ask me. If you keep silent, then I don't know what is the problem. Jadi sebelum dijual pada 1 November diamortize dulu to get the carrying value at November 1st. Berapa carrying value pada November 1st? Berapa book value at November 1st? How to get the carrying value or the book value? Then we can calculate the amortization from July to November. And this 522 will increase the debt investment. So debt investment on November 1st will be 95671 plus 522. This is carrying value of bonds in November 1st. So this is the carrying value of the bonds at November 1st, 2021. The selling price, as I told you, is actually 99.75% times the nominal value. Apa itu nilai nominal? Berapa nilai nominal dari bonds kita ini tadi? It is 100,000. Nilai nominalnya 100,000. So this is the price that the company will receive. On the other hand, the book value of the bonds is 96. So you sell 96 asset with 99 price, the company will record gain on sale of bonds. So the company record the cash is 99 plus the interest. How do you calculate this? The interest, the coupon will be 4/6 times 4,000. Bunganya itu kan 4,000 per 6 bulan. Sedangkan dari Juli ke November itu berapa bulan? 4 bulan, Juli, Agustus, September, Oktober. 4 bulan per 6 bulan dari 4,000. Okay. And then interest revenue karena udah diterima duluan, kemudian debt investment. Ini juga mungkin luput dari analisis Anda. Karena typical mahasiswa memang agak tidak mau berpikir ya, meskipun punya otak. So if you have debt investment now in November 1st, and then you sell it, okay, you sell to the other. So the new holder, yeah, the buyer, will receive 6 months interest from the company. Jadi si pembeli itu akan dapat bunga 6 bulan dari debitur, dari yang menerbitkan bonds, nanti pada 1 Januari. Padahal dia pegang cuma dari November, Desember, dia pegang cuma 2 bulan. Nanti dia terima 6 bulan interest. Nah, Pak, bagaimana 4 bulan? 4 bulan kan yang pegang company ini, si Robinson. Oke, berarti selama 4 bulan, Juli, Agustus, September, Oktober, Robinson berhak atas interest payment kan, karena dia pegang 4 bulan. So Robinson will ask the buyer to pay the interest in advance. Jadi Robinson minta sama pembelinya, you nanti kan dapat bunga 6 bulan, padahal you pegang cuma 2 bulan, tuh yang 4 bulan kasihkan ke saya, karena itu hak saya. That's why in this case, the cash include the interest, the accrued interest from July to November 1st. You get it? Ngerti nggak? Ngerti keterlaluan. Ini July, August, September, October, and this is the first November. Robinson hold these bonds 4 months, okay, during this period. Okay, as the consequences, Robinson should receive the interest, 4 months interest. Okay. However, the payment of the interest will be 1st January 2022. Kan? Nanti bayaran pembayarannya itu nanti Januari. And the new holder, pemegang obligasi ini yang beli ini pegang mulai November sampai 1 Januari nanti, dia cuman entitled 2 months di sini. Nah, sebagai konsekuensinya si buyer-nya itu bayarin dulu, nalangin dulu 4 bulan bunga kepada Robinson. Oke. Okay. Jadi ini cash include the accrued interest. Did you get it? Okay, and then company, due to the sales, the company report gain on sale. Ada gain on sale yang harus dicatat. Oke. Okay. Itu amortized cost. Itu amortized cost. The same as you did in chapter 14. But from different side. In chapter 14, you did from debtor side. And now in chapter 17, you do accounting for bonds from the creditor or from the investor side. Dari sisi yang berbeda. This is what we call as amortized cost. Okay, finish. Second, we have the second class, right? Which is help for collection and selling as well. So you have this investment until its maturity, but there is a possibility to sell the investment in any date when you need cash. Okay. Actually, debt investment help for collection and selling follow the same accounting entries as debt investment help for collection or amortized costs. Jadi sama persis dengan yang tadi dilakukan, except every reporting date, the company should adjust the carrying value of bonds into the market value of bonds. Jadi repotnya dua. The amortized cost method tetap harus dijalankan seperti yang tadi kita jelaskan in the first. Ditambah setiap akhir periode pelaporan, nilai investmentnya harus di-adjust, disesuaikan dengan nilai market bonds investment. Okay, so at each reporting date, companies adjust the amortized cost to fair value, and any difference between the carrying value and the amount, the fair value, will be recorded as unrealized gain or loss. And this unrealized gain or loss is part of other comprehensive income and not part of the profit loss. And please remember back to the chapter 2 of this intermediate accounting, or chapter, I think it is in intermediate accounting 1. Please remember in an intermediate accounting 1, you did learn that profit loss statement has 2 sections. The first section is to get net income, and the second section present the other comprehensive income. So, the total of net income and other comprehensive income called comprehensive income. So Comprehensive income is net income plus other comprehensive income. Then, the unrealized gain or loss due to the fair value adjustment is part of other comprehensive income in this setting. Okay. So, for example, a company purchases 100,000 bonds, 10% 5-year bond on January 1st, 2019 with interest payable on July and January 1st. The bonds sell for 111, which is premium price. This is premium price, which result in bond premium. Okay, we know it's bond premium. And the effective interest rate of 8%. Of course, it is the bond was sold for higher than the nominal value. This is the nominal value because the bonds offer 10% higher interest rate than the market rate. Okay, karena apa namanya? Kupon rate-nya 10%, sedangkan market rate hanya 8%. Many investors want to buy these bonds. That's why the price increase. Okay. Once the company purchased the bonds, then the company record that investment on debit and cash credit. Okay. And then the company should develop the same amortized cost table, which is to amortize the premium, to amortize bond premium. Okay, to amortize bond premium means to bring the carrying value of bonds into the nominal value of bonds. Okay, so amortizing the premium will reduce the investment in bonds carrying amount to the nominal value. Jadi amortisasi preminya ini membuat carrying amount bondsnya semakin berkurang, sama akhirnya sama dengan nominal value of bondsnya. Okay. So as you may see here. On July 1st, the company will receive cash, 5,000, and amortize the investment. So the company debit cash, 5,000, and then reduce and debit the interest. Credit the debt investment and interest revenue as well. Jadi di sini debt investment dikurangi supaya nanti nilainya sama dengan nominal value. Okay, so at December 31st, 2019, which is in this date, we know that the carrying value of bonds is 106,000. Okay, 106,000. To get this carrying amounts, we have to record the premium amortization and also accrued the interest revenue. So we record interest receivable, 5,000. We amortize the premium by crediting that investment and then record the interest revenue. Okay, so in total, the interest revenue for 2019 is 8,621. Okay, we present this interest revenue on profit loss statement. Okay. So not only that, as I said before, at each reporting date, the company should adjust the carrying value to the fair value. So assume the fair value of the bonds is 105. And now we have 106 carrying amount. Means we have to reduce the carrying amount into the fair value, 105. How to do it? So we record loss, which is unrealized loss. As the difference between 105 and the carrying amount of bonds. And then we debit fair value adjustment. We credit fair value adjustment. So this unrealized cost, unrealized gain or loss is part of the equity. If you want to more specific, this account will be reported on the profit loss statement in the second part on OCI part. There will be unrealized gain or loss, 1732. And this OCI is accumulated on the equity. As accumulated other comprehensive income. Namanya gitu. Jadi, unrealized holding gain or loss-nya dilaporkan di OCI. OCI ini nanti di-present di equity section di balance sheet dengan nama accumulated other comprehensive income. Sedangkan net income yang di sini accumulated to retained earnings. So please check chapter, if I'm not mistaken, chapter 5 or chapter 4 in your intermediate accounting book. And what about the fair value adjustment? Fair value adjustment will be presented as part of the investment account. Jadi ini akan dimasukkan dalam investment account. Investment account dari 106 akan berkurang 1732 menjadi 105. Okay. So what if the company has several bonds, not only one bonds. So they have to do the same thing for each bonds they have. Jadi setiap obligasi yang mereka punya, they have to do the same thing. They have to build the amortization schedule and so on. And then at any reporting date, they have to adjust the amortized cost carrying value. Ini jadi carrying value atau nilai buku menurut tabel amortisasi disesuaikan dengan fair value bonds-nya setiap periode pelaporan. Periode pelaporan bisa setahun sekali, bisa setahun dua kali, bisa setahun empat kali, tergantung periode pelaporan perusahaan. And the unrealized gain or loss recorded at that reporting date. So from this computation, we can get this fair value adjustment turun 9537, means from the total investment, the fair value of this investment are now decreasing. Jadi dari total investasi ternyata nilainya menurun 9537. And this fair value adjustment will be reported as part of the investment account. Jadi dia bergabung ke investment account, membuat investment account kita decreasing. So what if, so how to do the adjustment journal? We debit the unrealized gain or loss part of the equity of the comprehensive income and credit the fair value adjustment. Okay, so what if we sell the securities held for trading and help for collection and sale and selling? If we sell If the company sell the bonds before maturity date, then the company must make entries to remove the debt investment account. Of course, ya kan harus di remove. Kemudian, any realized gain or loss from the sale will be reported as other income or expense in the income statement. Di profit loss kita di bagian pertama. Misalkan seperti ini, the amortized cost-nya adalah 94, kemudian the selling price is 90, so loss on sale-nya adalah 4,000. Okay. Kemudian 4.214 tadi dilaporkan sebagai part of the income statement. Now, itu tadi kan dijual satu ya, jadi portofolionya kan punya dua. The company has two bonds. So now it sells one of the bonds. Kan? Dia jual satu, maka tinggal satu. So, assuming no other purchases and sales, maka bondsnya tinggal satu. There is only one bond, which is Anacom, in the portfolio. Jadi tinggal satu saja di akun investasinya. And now the amortized cost according to the amortization table, it is 200,000. But however, the fair value is now 195, so ada kerugian unrealized gain or loss-nya sebesar 5,000. Tapi dari previous year, we have a fair value adjustment yang nilainya minus 9,537. Okay. Jadi pada tahun ini kita harusnya punya fair value adjustment minus 5,000, tapi tahun sebelumnya kita punya minus 9,537. Jadi kita harus buat fair value adjustment-nya dari minus 9,000 menjadi minus 5. Oke. Okay. So fair value adjustment-nya akan didebit 4,537 dengan mendebit fair value adjustment dan mengkredit unrealized gain. We credit unrealized gain berarti kan terjadi keuntungan, Pak. Bagaimana terjadi keuntungan padahal investasinya di sini nilainya menurun dari 200 menjadi 195. Investment account-nya menurun dari 200 menjadi 195. Tapi kenapa adjustment-nya kok gain? Karena kita previously punya 9,537 loss, unrealized loss dari previous year. Nah, unrealized loss-nya saat ini menjadi lebih sedikit. Unrealized loss-nya menjadi lebih sedikit, menjadi hanya 5,000. Means that we earn some unrealized gain. Karena loss kita dari 9,000 menjadi hanya tinggal 5,000. So di sini unrealized gain-nya dicatat di kredit, means it is actually gain. Okay. So at the financial statement kita punya debt investment 195 sesuai dengan fair value at the reporting date. And then interest receivable kita harus hitung misalkan berapa nanti hasil perhitungannya dari karena tidak ada informasi, pasti ada interest receivable-nya tapi kita nggak tahu berapa. And then on the equity section we have this accumulated other comprehensive income 5,000. 5,000 itu adalah ini ya, unrealized gain, hasil penyesuaian nilai wajar obligasi. And then on the income statement kita punya interest revenue and also loss on sale of investment dari penjualan obligasi yang pertama. So next, the last section of part one is debt investment in a trading scheme. So bagaimana perusahaan memperlakukan investment in bonds if the investment is held for trading. Companies often hold debt investment with the intention of selling them in short period of time. So these debt investment are often referred to as trading investment. So we call this as trading investment. Companies report trading in securities at fair value, of course. And then unrealized holding gain and losses part of the fair value adjustment reported as part of net income, which is the first section of the profit loss statement. Jadi bedanya, kalau yang tadi, yang held for collection and selling, unrealized gain-nya menjadi bagian dari equity, but kalau held for collection, held for trading, unrealized gain-nya adalah bagian dari profit loss. Ya, dimasukkan di net income, dimasukkan di retained earning, dan seterusnya. Holding gain or loss is the net change in the fair value of security from one period to another, exclusive of dividend or interest revenue recognized but not received. Ya, pokoknya ini selisih penilaian saja. And we don't calculate the amortized cost. This is the good news. So in debt investment for trading, we don't calculate the amortized cost. We don't make that amortization table. Yeah. So purely we use the fair value of the bonds. So for example, here we have three bonds with cost. Okay, this is the cost. The cost from the harga belinya, kemudian ini fair value-nya, kemudian ada unrealized gain or loss-nya, sebenarnya sama. In the end, kita harus akui ada fair value adjustment. Fair value adjustment dicatat seperti ini. Fair value adjustment-nya akhirnya positif, jadi menambah total investment. So we debit fair value adjustment and credit unrealized gain or loss. And this unrealized gain or loss adalah part of the net income. Okay. Sebenarnya sama dengan yang sebelumnya, cuman beda tempatnya aja si fair value adjustment. Si siapa unrealized holding gain or loss-nya ini mau ditaruh di mana? Sama. However, companies have the option to report all the financial assets at fair value. Jadi yang amortized cost, yang held for collection tadi amortized cost, ataupun yang semi yaitu held for collection and selling, itu bisa dimasukkan ke fair value option semua. With all gains and losses related to changes in fair value reported in the income statement. Jadi punya option untuk itu, misalkan mau lebih simpel daripada bikin amortized table-nya complicated, then you can choose the fair value option. But it has the cost as well. Cost-nya adalah you have to adjust the fair value anytime the reporting date. Ya. So for example, ini ada investment, kemudian nilainya dari 100 menjadi 113, fair value-nya jadi harus disesuaikan. In this situation, debt investment account berubah, kemudian tidak menggunakan fair value adjustment lagi, tapi langsung pakai debt investment, jadi langsung debt investment-nya dinaikkan, tidak pakai akun perantara fair value adjustment. Ini lebih simpel ya, lebih simpel secara accounting, tapi complicated-nya atau komplikasinya ada di adjustment yang harus dilakukan setiap akhir periode. Okay, and once the company use fair value option, then Hardy, the company must continue to use fair value option until the company no longer has ownership of the security, sampai dijual. So I will stop at this point. The rest will be discussed next week. Okay. And after this, you still have time to do the post test. And let me give you one. Homework. Okay. Let me choose the homework for you. It is from the book, of course. Okay. Please do problem 17.3, and submit your answer in PDF today. So I will prepare the submission field on Aula. Problem 17.3, and as usual, I will ask you to explain your answer next week before the class. Okay? Any question? No? Then thanks for your attention. Thanks for your participation. God bless you. Stay healthy, stay safe, and see you next week, inshallah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.